Good afternoon. Welcome to Music and Message. This is a weekly series that features musical performances and spoken reflection from diverse religious and spiritual perspectives. These gatherings seek to nourish the spirit and soul of our campus community. And as we begin, I acknowledge with respect the Onondaga Nation, firekeepers of the Haudenosaunee, the indigenous people on whose ancestral lands Syracuse University now stands. My name is Brian Conkle. I serve as Dean of Hendricks Chapel here at Syracuse University, and I am honored to welcome the Syracuse University Oratorio Society, directed by Dr. John Warren, to perform Alzheimer's Stories, composed by Robert S. Cohen. We at Hendricks Chapel are honored to serve as hosts for this stirring performance. Once again, we'll be reminded of the ways in which music can nourish the spirit and soul, because music is in many ways the language of the spirit and the soul. I do wish to offer a special thank you to all who helped to make this program possible. In addition to the speakers and artists, I wish to give thanks to Alex Snow, Julie Cajola, the staff here at Hendricks Chapel, our partners throughout campus, as well as Brian Simons from Sensational Events. Each and every week here during Music and Message, we thank Dr. Annie Laver, Dr. Pepe Calvar, our colleagues from the Settner School of Music in the College of Visual and Performing Arts for their leadership in helping to make this all possible. And of course, to our supporters that contribute to the Dean's Fund as well as the Malmgren Fund, we are grateful, for without such generous contributions, these opportunities simply would not be possible. As we prepare for what will surely be a powerful experience and what has been a powerful week here as we remember Pan Am 103 over this last few days here at Syracuse University, I am pleased to share that our composer, Robert S. Cohen, is in attendance today, and I do have the pleasure of introducing him. Mr. Cohen has written music for chorus, orchestra, chamber ensemble, dance, and theater, and has been the recipient of numerous awards and commissions, including a New Jersey State Council on the Arts Fellowship, an American Music Center grant, a Meet the Composer Award, New York Composers Circle Award, the 2011 New England String Quartet International Composition Competition, and several grants from the Geraldine R. Dodge Foundation. His works have been performed in such prestigious venues as Carnegie Hall, Severance Hall, Symphony Space, Barge Music, and the Sophia Opera House, and of course now the prestigious Hendricks Chapel. Alzheimer's Stories for soloists, chorus, and large ensemble with libretto by 2012 Grammy winner Herschel Garfin was commissioned and premiered by the Susquehanna Chorale in 2009 and has been performed in major cities throughout the United States and received its European premiere in Vienna in June of 2014. It is a great honor to host a performance of this important work with the composer in attendance. I do ask you to bring a warm Syracuse welcome to Robert S. Cohen.
Oh, this is such a pleasure. As I mentioned to the chorus earlier, the greatest gift a composer can have is having their work performed. And these days, to have a live performance is just amazing. And this is actually the first live performance of any of my choral works in 2 years, so this is extra special. This is such a wonderful venue, and I am so beholden to everybody who's involved in this performance. When I was originally commissioned this work, it sort of came out of nowhere, and I got a call from the Susquehanna Valley Chorale. We had previously discussed doing something together, but I hadn't heard back from them for a couple of years, and the conductor said, I have some really good news, and I have some interesting news. Interesting is always a word that you have to be careful with. Good news is we have funding for you to do a piece. And the interesting news is that it has to be on Alzheimer's disease. And my first reaction was, oh my God, how do you do anything on Alzheimer's disease? I mean, what kind of a project is that? I called a librettist I had just worked with, Herschel Garfein, who's about the only librettist I've worked with who I thought could tackle this kind of project. And his first words were actually run away, right out of Monty Python. He says, this can't be done. I could never do it justice. What do I know about Alzheimer's? I'd actually gone through Alzheimer's disease with my stepmother, so I knew very much the details and the whole arc of it. So this, I let this lay for a few weeks, and then I said to myself, you know, who else is gonna do something like this? I'm sure everybody would have the same reaction. So I decided to push him, and I pushed him, and I pushed him, and then he finally said, look, let's take a drive out to Pennsylvania and talk to the choir. And on the way, he got this brilliant idea to ask the choir and friends of the choir and family of the choir to put together stories of members of their family or friends who had Alzheimer's disease. And we got about 80 stories from that, and of which we used, I think, 18 or 19. And that formed the basis of the piece. We didn't really know where we were going with it at that point and how to structure it. But Herschel, who's just a master librettist, went on the internet and looked up Dr. Alzheimer. And lo and behold, the entire transcript of his dialogue with his first patient was on the internet. So he used that as the basis for the first movement of the piece called Numbers. It's a very impartial look at the number of people who have the disease, what the future of the disease is going to be, and the actual dialogue between Dr. Alzheimer and his patient. The middle movement is the stories, and both Herschel and I have a background in musical theater, so we both tried to lend some humor because it would be very difficult to write a piece that went on without a little humor, especially dealing with this disease. Little did we know at the time that the idea that music has such a profound effect on patients with Alzheimer's disease was going to become a scientific fact. And in fact, for any of you, and I encourage you to go online if you didn't see it, 2 weeks ago there was a segment on 60 Minutes about Tony Bennett. Tony Bennett has Alzheimer's disease. He doesn't know really where he is a lot of the time, who his children are, who his wife is, but he got up in front of an audience in New York, Radio City Music Hall, and sang for an hour songs perfectly, every note, every lyric. So it's been like an amazing journey for me to understand that a work that I wrote would have such a profound effect that we didn't even know at the time that this was going on. And it's something that I feel, there's no way to describe the feeling of pleasure I get from hearing this work and that I've contributed something to allay the fears of people who are dealing with this horrible disease. Interestingly enough, the last movement, which is called For the Caregivers, we really struggled with. We had no idea what to write, how to write it. We didn't want to continue with more stories because we thought we had done that in the middle movement. And then somebody sent us this very interesting story, and it was a member of the choir who was visiting her father every week in a nursing home, and he had Alzheimer's disease. And she would sing to him songs that he knew, some of the classics, and one day she went to visit him and she didn't know what to sing. And he said, sing anything. And that became the basis for the libretto of the last movement. And again, I am so very grateful to everybody involved in this project. I know it's a difficult piece. I know it's taken a lot of time, and thank you for allowing me to come here and share this with you.
I will now share some stories shared by members of Oratorio Society with their experience with Alzheimer's disease. Huey Lee Warren. This story was written by Dr. John Warren. Huey was his grandfather. When I was about 10, my father's parents moved from central Alabama to an apartment about a quarter mile from our house in Nashville. My dad was the only close relative, so it helped them to have him nearby. When I was in high school, my grandmother was in a hospital, and my grandfather and father had visited her and were ready to drive home. They had driven separately since my dad came from work. So my grandfather followed my dad as they drove home. In the heart of the city, they came to an interstate interchange. My dad, driving slowly, took I-65 south to the right and watched in his mirror as my grandfather took I-40 east to the left. The police found him 36 hours later in southern Kentucky, asleep in the car as it sat in the middle of a country road perpendicular to the lanes. That was the beginning of a lot of lifestyle changes for our family. Nursing homes for my grandfather, my grandmother moving in with us. I remember taking walks with my grandfather near our house. He would see the interstate and ask me, "Where does that road go? I need to get home, and I just don't know how to go." Erna Churchill Coles. This story was written by Rick Coles. Erna was his mother. Erna Churchill Coles, my mother, died on March 30th, 2004. She died on that day, but she had been gone well before then. She had Alzheimer's disease with Lewy bodies. We began to acknowledge her condition around 2000, but we feel that she must have known before that. She covered up her mental and physical lapses. She made sure that she always had a crossword puzzle handy to keep her mind sharp, but it became clear that her mind and body were failing. She had always been the quintessential middle-class American homemaker. She took care of everything, but when she became ill and needed help, Dad suddenly realized that he had to step up, and he did. He prepared the breakfasts and washed up afterwards. He did the laundry and helped her in the middle of the night when she had accidents. My mother had a winning and beautiful smile that could light up the room. Throughout her life, she led various community, political, and local church programs and projects. By the time she turned 80, all of that was gone. She couldn't remember faces or places or names. On the day Mom died, she was still alert enough to know of our presence. We told ourselves that she was waiting for us to get there before she died. Who knows? That thought comforted us, at least. And so, the five of us gathered around her bed and held her hand. We said a prayer. I whispered in her ear that Dad would be okay and that she could let go. She died in her sleep that night. Weeping may last for the night, but joy comes with the morning. Psalm 30, verse 5. Kathy's family. This story was written by Kathy Zubal Storings. We think Alzheimer's runs in my family, though I do like to tell myself it is age-related memory loss and not an official diagnosis. My paternal great-grandmother's memory slowly faded. One day, they found her wandering the street of her hometown, scared and crying, saying she wanted to go home. My paternal grandmother, her daughter, also faded before our eyes, from a book-loving crossword wizard to a shell of a woman who needed to be spoon-fed like a baby. My maternal grandfather suffered a similar fate. Memory loss, taking double doses of his medication because he forgot he had already taken it. He insisted every male grandchild was my brother Mark, the firstborn, even though my cousin would say, "Randy, Grandpa, this is Randy." I am now watching my mother slowly fade away. She repeats herself constantly, asks the same questions, and at this point knows and acknowledges her memory is going. 2 weeks ago, just after her husband passed away, the family was sitting on her front porch, and she spontaneously burst into song. "Life is just a bowl of cherries. Don't take it serious. It's too mysterious. You work, you save, you worry so. But you can't take your dough when you go, go, go. Oh, life is just a bowl of cherries, so live and laugh at it all." She sang with gusto and a smile on her face and did not notice the tears my sister-in-law and I wiped from our eyes. Life may be just a bowl of cherries, but watching her fade away is the pits. And with my family history, I selfishly worry if I am destined for the same sad, slow fade into memory loss and being nothing but a shell of the person I am. Bud Corcoran. This story was written by Joan Stevens. Bud was her father. When my dad was still able to talk, I went to pick him up from the nursing home for his birthday. I found him in the physical therapy room, full of therapists and other residents. As I walked in the door, my dad called, "Oh, here's my daughter. We're going to sing for you." My first thought was, "Oh, Daddy, this is so inappropriate," immediately followed by the decision that I could not disappoint or embarrass this beautiful, vulnerable man, and I would never see these people again. So we stepped up to the parallel bars and sang, "Let Me Call You Sweetheart," me on lead, and my dad with his beautiful Irish tenor harmony. Every person in that room had a better day because of it. Later, when he could not complete a sentence, when the thoughts got lost after a few words, he could still sing all the words and the tenor harmony to all the songs he had learned in his youth. And later yet, when he could no longer speak, if my sister and I would sing to him, his whole face would light up with heart-wrenching joy. At the end, although he could no longer know I was daughter or Joni, his eyes still lit with joy when I came into his room. He could not say beloved, but I still was. Barbara Yetzler. This story was written by Paul Yetzler. Barbara was his mother. A lot of anecdotes I could tell are too painful to relate and others are inappropriately humorous. But here are two that I'd like to share. My mother looked at a picture of herself with my father, to whom she was married for 53 years. She told me, "This is a guy I used to go with. He was crazy about me, but I didn't like him that much, so I broke it off." Toward the end of her life, she didn't recognize her granddaughter anymore. And although she could speak my name and knew that I was her son, the relationship didn't seem to mean anything to her. But whenever there was music playing, she knew all the words and boldly sang along. Ruth, the cake lady of Western New York. The story was written by me. Ruth was my grandmother. My grandmother was a wonderful, loving person, but she was known throughout Buffalo for being a cake decorator. Her designs were elaborate, her attention to detail exquisite. She had scrapbooks filled with pictures of her cakes, from animal-shaped cakes to gorgeous wedding cakes to random things like cash register cakes. She did everything. My favorite was one she made for my 5th birthday party. It was Finding Nemo themed with an orange-flavored cake on the inside, and it was delicious. Near the end of her life, she moved to Syracuse to spend more time with my family. One of the many perks of having her nearby was she provided a frequent supply of desserts. But it wasn't long after she moved that she eventually started forgetting, constantly needing our help as she struggled to live her life. I will never forget the last cake my grandma ever made for us. It was a deflated chocolate bundt cake with thin, slimy icing that ultimately was inedible. something my grandma had mastered over her life. She forgot how to do. What always interested me, though, was that she retained music so well, despite her forgetting other things. She would sing along to the 40s radio stations in the car. The last time I saw her, she had both forgotten my name and sang a flawless performance of Hello, Dolly. My experience with my grandma is part of the reason I love music. Music was a cure for her illness, albeit temporary.
name.
Question.
What is your husband's name?
Ich hab mich mehr lang.
for not putting me in one of those homes. Navy, oh, we raised some hell.
Yes, Dan. Yes, Dan.
In any port, the order was be back on board at midnight, standing on your feet. If you were late, or showed up drunk, or had eye and eye till you smelled like a skunk, then KP swab the deck, hit the rack, you'll never go back on shore again. I told you about the Navy, oh, we raised some hell.
Yes, you raised some hell.
Yes, you raised some hell.
order was, be back on board at midnight, standing on your feet.
That's right.
If you were late,
showed up drunk.
I smelled like a skunk. And came peace on the deck. Hit the wreck, you'll never go back on shore again. Raised some hell. As he died, his arms lifted, and his fingers looked like dancing.
He fell, they sailed, they came ashore.
I would whisper that I love.